The BSON Lecture Series is a new series of monthly webinars which aim at the full integration of Palestine into the global learning community.
We sponsor discourses on subjects of cultural, scientific, and societal importance by leading research experts and public intellectuals of varied heritage and viewpoints.
These interactive webinars are free and open to the public, and recordings of each will be posted soon after the end of each lecture.
The SAN Center for Research and Development is a non-partisan civil society organization that was founded back in 1989. We work on connecting young scholars with the global community of research to contribute to the creation and establishment of these connections and this community of learning, where sciences of all forms can be used and utilized for the benefit of man.
The BSON Lecture Series is the response of the international academic community to the Israeli attacks against the inalienable right of the Palestinian people to education and academic freedom. We stand in solidarity with the six Palestinian NGOs targeted by the Israeli government, and through them, with the entirety of Palestinian civil society.
Welcome to the BSON Lecture Series. I'm Haynes Miller, a member of the organizing
committee
of this wide-ranging seminar. This lecture will be available in simultaneous translation to Arabic. To invoke it, click on the image of the globe at the bottom of your Zoom screen. By selecting it, you'll be given an option of language, English or Arabic. I now invite BLS co-organizer Ahmed Abbas to repeat this message in Arabic.
شكراً هينز. المتابعون على الزوم والذين يفضلون الاستماع إلى المحاضرة بالترجمة الفورية إلى اللغة العربية يرجى النقر على أيقونة الترجمة في أسفل الشاشة التي تمثلها الكرة الأرضية واختيار العربية. هذا الخيار غير متاح لمستمعي الفيسبوك. شكراً جزيلاً لنمير قسيس الذي يقدم الترجمة الفورية.
Thank you, Ahmed. شكراً. Before introducing today's speaker, let me also point out the chat button at the bottom of your Zoom window. Please put questions you may have into the chat. You can also post questions if you're using Facebook live stream. These questions will be collected, and I'll put as many of them as there's time for to our speaker in the Q&A after the lecture. The post-lecture conversation is shaped by your questions. Nancy Kanwisher received her BS and PhD from MIT, working under the direction of Professor Molly Potter. After a postdoc as a MacArthur Fellow in Peace and International Security and a second postdoc in the lab of Anne Treisman at UC Berkeley, Kanwisher held faculty positions at UCLA and then at Harvard before returning to MIT in 1997. She is now an investigator at the McGovern Institute for Brain Research and Walter A. Rosenblith Professor of Cognitive Neuroscience in the MIT Department of Brain and Cognitive Sciences. Nancy uses brain imaging and other methods to discover the functional organization of the human brain. She sees this as a window into the architecture of the mind. As we'll see, she's interested in how the brain produces some of the most subtle and amazing components of human consciousness. How do we understand the functional properties of our physical environment? How do we conceive of what other people are experiencing? Nancy's interest in the physical basis of our connection with other people is inextricably connected with her longstanding commitment to the defense of human rights, and in particular of Palestinian rights. She co-launched the Harvard-MIT Divest from Israel campaign in 2002, She visited Palestine a number of times between 2001 and 2010, giving talks in person at Birzeit and Al-Quds, and attending protests in Belin and the South Hebron Hills. I remember watching on HuffPost a beautiful video she made with Joyce Ajluni of a drive through part of the West Bank, simply pointing out the manifold impacts of the Israeli occupation. Kanwisher has received many awards recognizing her impact, both as a researcher and as a teacher. She received the Trolland Award from the National Academy of Sciences, the Golden Brain Award from the Minerva Foundation, and the Carvalho-Heineken Prize in 2018. In 2002, she was named a McVicker Faculty Fellow, MIT's most prestigious teaching award. She is a member of the National Academy of Sciences and of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Please welcome Professor Nancy Kanwisher.
Hi there. Thanks, Haynes. Can somebody give me a thumbs up if you're hearing me okay? Awesome. Great. Well, it is a huge honor to be giving this lecture, and thanks so much for that kind introduction, Haynes. I wish I could be there in person, but I will accept this as a wonderful substitute. So I want to start my talk with some good news. And the good news is that in my field of human cognitive neuroscience, the study of the human brain, we've made lots of progress in the last 25 years. And one way to appreciate that is to step back to the approximate state of knowledge just a few decades ago in 1990, before the invention of functional MRI. And at the time, we knew the approximate location of a number of mental functions, like language processing, recognizing faces, and directing attention to different parts of the visual space. And we knew that from studies of patients who had the great misfortune of having damage to part of their brain and who selectively lost these functions after brain damage. But that was more or less it. There were not very many functions that we could identify the brain locus of. But then functional MRI came along. And functional MRI is just a method that uses the very same MRI machines that are present in hospitals all around the world, but uses them to look not just at structure, but function. And the basic idea is that the brain is like a muscle in the sense that if some part of the brain is active and the neurons in that region increase their firing, you need to send extra blood to supply those neurons. Just as if you get up and run around, you need to increase blood flow to the muscles in your leg. And so because blood flow changes in the brain, that's something we can pick up with an MRI machine. And so what this method has revealed over the last few decades is a number of distinct regions of the brain for which we have a pretty good idea what that little patch of cortex does. And each of the regions in this diagram here are present in pretty much every normal person. And I think that's cool, but this is a very schematic diagram. So let me say a little bit more about what it means to stick a word label on a little patch of the brain. Let me show you some actual data. And so here's a picture of the bottom surface of the brain, looking up from the bottom with the two hemispheres, with the posterior of the two hemispheres facing outward. This is the back of the right hemisphere and the back of the left hemisphere here. This is a picture of the brain of a recent member of my lab, who was a very good subject and who got scanned a lot with functional MRI, so we could map out many different functions in his brain. And what you see in gray is the cortical surface, which is normally folded up inside the head. So the cortex is the size and thickness of a large pizza. And to fit that large pizza inside your skull, you need to crumple it up. And that's why brains are all wrinkly. But to look at the actual map on the surface of the cortex, we mathematically unfold it. And that's why it's smooth in these images here. The dark strips are the parts that used to be inside a fold before we mathematically unfolded that part of the cortex. So that's what's in gray. what about this, the colored patches? Well, this little blue patch right there in the right hemisphere, on the bottom surface of the right hemisphere, is a region that we named long ago the fusiform face area, because it's in a fold of the brain called the fusiform gyrus. And it responds like this. So this is a magnitude of the MRI response when people look at faces in blue, when they look at pictures of body parts like hands and feet in purple, when they look at scenes in green and other things are in the other bars here. So this is the MRI response, which is correlated with neural activity in that region. And so you can see it's just higher when this person is looking at faces than when they look at other things. Okay, so right next door, that little green patch has a very different response profile. So that patch of brain responds much more in functional MRI when the person is looking at images of scenes, indoor and outdoor scenes. Anytime you look at a photograph of a place you could be in, you get a strong response there. And look at the response to faces. It's zero. That means the same as our baseline, which is staring at a dot. So out in the left hemisphere on the bottom of the brain is a particularly interesting patch called the visual word form area. And it's named that because it responds like this when you look at pictures, when you look at visually presented words or letter strings compared to when you look at all of these other things. So this region is of particular interest because we know that that region arises from this individual's experience. And we know that because this selective response to visually presented words doesn't show up until after people learn to read, and it only responds to orthographies you know. So our valiant translator, Numer, if we scanned him, we would see a strong response in that region of his brain looking at Arabic words, words written out in Arabic, or English words. But if we scanned me, who doesn't speak Arabic, we would see only a response when I look at words in English, not written in Arabic orthography. Okay, out on the lateral surface of the brain, we find more good stuff here. These little purple patches here respond more when people look at images of bodies, hands and feet, than when they look at faces or words or scenes or anything else. And while all of these regions are responding to complex visual information, we also see in orange here, regions that respond to the sounds of speech. So right now, those regions in all of your brains, the neurons are very active because you're hearing me speak. And even if you're hearing me speak in English and there was not a translator, those regions would still be active because they're responding not to the meaning of speech, but just the sounds of speech, okay? So all of this raises a question. Do we have these little specialized patches of brain only for processing aspects of perceptual information? Or do we also have them for higher level information, for maybe aspects of thought? So this is a question that's been debated in our field for centuries. And I think major progress has happened very recently, especially with the work of my colleague, Evelina Fedorenko, shown here. And so what Ev did was to scan people with functional MRI while they read sentences compared to scrambled sentences with no meaning. And she found these red regions in the temporal lobe and the frontal lobe up there responding to language. Now that part was not news. Many people had, we knew from brain damage studies 200 years ago that patches here and here were involved in language processing. But because Ev could identify those regions in each participant individually, she could then study them in detail and ask, okay, do those same regions that respond when you understand the meaning of a sentence, are they also involved when you engage in other aspects of cognition? So she tested many different aspects of cognition. The details here don't matter. She had people doing arithmetic tasks, she had them listening to music. She had them doing holding information and working memory, a whole suite of other tasks that people had argued might overlap with language in the brain. And she simply asked, do those regions that respond when you understand the meaning of a sentence also respond during these other tasks? And the answer is shown here. This is a language region sometimes known as Wernicke's area. And you can see its response when people read sentences they understand. And when they read scrambled non-word strings that don't have any meaning, and here's the response to all of those other conditions, basically no response in any of these other tasks. And similarly, if you look in the frontal lobe at a region that's basically Broca's area, you see the same thing, a strong and selective response during understanding of language that is not engaged when you do all of these other cognitive tasks. And I really love this result because it's not just evidence for another selective blob on the brain, much as I find those fun and entertaining. I think this also answers a question that probably many in this audience have already wondered about, which is, what is the relationship between thought and language? Do we think in language? Could we think if we didn't have language? And I think these data show us actually very crisply with data that thought and language are not the same thing in the brain. In fact, even stronger evidence for that comes from the work of Rosemary Varley in England. She's been studying people with global aphasia with broad damage to a large percent of the left hemisphere that really robs people of language, both their ability to understand and produce language. And that's a devastating disorder for people with global aphasia. But it has enabled Rosemary to show something astonishing, which is that even people who have essentially no language abilities whatsoever can still do pretty much everything you would have thought would require language. These people can still do. So they can do math problems, they can do logic problems, they can appreciate music, they can hold information in working memory, and they can think about what another person is thinking. And I think that's quite astonishing as evidence for this just broad idea that thought is really a different thing from language in the brain. And that also brings up I think, really astonishing work of my colleague, Rebecca Sachs, who studied this little pink patch right here. And what she showed is that that region is very selectively engaged when you think about what another person is thinking. And if that seems a little bit crazy, like, okay, now Nancy has gone off the deep end and is saying like really crazy things, reflect on the fact that actually it's really kind of the essence of being a human being to spend a lot of your time thinking about what other people are thinking. It's what we do every day when we encounter friends or people we don't know. We care more about what's going on inside in their brains, in their minds, than what we see on the outside. And we make a lot of sophisticated inferences about what they're thinking. And so we have a special patch of brain for just this critical kind of quintessentially human function. Okay. All right. So that is my, let me hasten to add that although I tend to focus in my research on these patches of brain with very specific functions, it's not the case for every patch of brain. In fact, these white regions up here are sometimes called the multiple demand system because they respond when you engage in multiple different kinds of demanding tasks. Kind of, they're sort of the opposite of all these other regions I've been talking about. They respond very broadly to lots of different kinds of tasks. And so they are very general purpose regions of the brain. And in some ways, they're an even deeper mystery about what goes on in those regions of the brain. And we see that by showing that in a whole suite of different kinds of tasks, if you compare a difficult condition that's in the solid bar with the easy version of the same task across a wide range of tasks, we see this higher response in a difficult compared to an easy condition that we don't see elsewhere in the brain. Okay, that's my whirlwind overview of some of my favorite regions of the brain that have been studied in detail over the last 20 some years. And so where has this gotten us? I think this is real progress. We now know that there's a set of functionally distinct regions of the brain that are present in pretty much everyone. And they conduct functions, including very abstract, uniquely human functions, like understanding language, like thinking about other people's thoughts, and like appreciating music. And I think this is cool because I like to think of this diagram as an initial sketch of who we are. But at the same time, this diagram is the barest beginning. And so I think the best way to think about this diagram is as a roadmap for research that raises a vast landscape of questions, probably many of which have already occurred to many of you. One of the first questions that comes to mind is that functional MRI that I've been talking about so far is a wonderful tool that has given us this map of the brain, but it has important shortcomings. And so just because some region of the brain responds selectively when you do a certain task, doesn't mean that you need that piece of brain to do that task. So it could be just kind of going along for the ride, not doing the fundamental work. And so in science, we want to know not just what goes along for the ride, what's correlated with what. We want to know what causes what. Causality is the essence of science. And functional MRI is simply not going to tell you. And that's why I was very excited when a few years ago, I got a phone call from a colleague telling me that this gentleman here was at the time awaiting neurosurgery in a hospital in Japan. Surgery for intractable epilepsy that did not respond to drugs. He was having many seizures a day that were just preventing a normal life. And in that circumstance, often neurosurgery is the best option. So neurosurgeons in Japan had placed electrodes all over the bottom of this guy's brain in order to map out functions and to chart their planned surgical route. And so I was shown this picture of where the electrodes were, and they said, would you like to collaborate with us measuring responses of these electrodes if the patient is willing? And I said, absolutely. And part of the reason that I was particularly interested in these electrodes, you can see in this picture of the bottom of my brain based on functional MRI, you can see my face areas in red, my scene processing regions in green, and my color processing regions in purple. And so these electrodes pretty clearly land in a similar location, and having data from actual electrodes in the brain, which is much closer to the neural source than functional MRI, is an incredible opportunity. So I sent them some stimuli, and this gentleman very kindly looked at them and allowed us to look at the responses in his brain. So here's some of what we saw. So these graphs are taken from the electrodes shown in this patch of the brain here along the fusiform gyrus, this guy's right hemisphere. And so you see, for example, that these electrodes 173 and 172 right there, here's time on the x-axis. And you see the response when he was looking at faces in here in red, and the response to all different kinds of images down here. And so if you were not so impressed when I showed you those bar charts at the beginning of the talk with face responses here and everything else there, and you were thinking, okay, there's some response to everything else, I think that's because functional MRI is not as precise a tool as direct recordings from the surface of the brain. And when you have direct recordings, you sometimes get extremely selective, in fact, exclusive responses to one class of stimulus. Okay, but I raised this question by asking about causality. And that was really answered when the neurosurgeons decided to not just measure responses of these electrodes, but to electrically stimulate those regions through those same electrodes to ask the patient what he experienced. This is something that neurosurgeons sometimes do as a stronger causal test of the function of a given region. So I'm going to show you a videotape of this gentleman being stimulated in his fusiform face area. He's speaking Japanese, but it doesn't matter. There are subtitles. Here he is looking at the neurosurgeon, and here's what he says. So he doesn't know where these electrodes are. You can see the stimulation here. He doesn't know there's a face area. He's just asked to say if anything changes.
I'm in the
So that shows the causal role of that region in face perception. Here we're asking, when he's stimulated in the same region while looking at a box, the stimulation of that face region affect his percept of other things? This is a kanji character on the card here.
One more time.
Okay, so you get the idea. What this shows is a striking causal specificity of that region. It doesn't just respond more to faces than anything else. If you stimulate that region, it only affects the person's percept of faces. If he's looking at a face, it changes. A face looks more like an anime character. If he's looking at a box or a kanji or a ball, he sees a face on top of it. And so this is the kind of strong evidence we have for the causal specificity of these regions. I don't have time to go into it now, but I have a video, you can ask me later in the Q&A, of the patient getting stimulated in these color-preferring patches. And he reports when he's stimulated there, seeing a rainbow on top of whatever he's looking at. Okay, another obvious question that has probably already occurred to many of you is like, okay, what else? We have all these weird specializations. What other specializations might live in there in the brain? And we've been asking that question in a number of different lines of research. We found one patch of brain here that we're still studying that seems to be involved in looking at interactions between people. So not just looking at one person or hearing their voice or looking at their face, but looking at two people interacting. And in fact, we can decode from the pattern of response of neural activity in that region, whether those two people are engaged in a positive and cooperative interaction or a negative and competitive interaction. We're also working on these regions roughly in the locations of the purple ones here. These regions seem to be engaged when you reason about the physical world, which actually you have to do every time you act. So you can't pick up a pencil or talk on your phone or walk across the room or plan any action whatsoever without first having some idea of how heavy is that object that I'm going to pick up. Will that surface support my weight if I walk on it, et cetera? So this understanding of the physical world is also very important, and we're trying to unpack what's going on in those regions of the brain. But the thing I want to talk about next is takes a rather different approach. And so far I've been talking about how we come up with hypotheses and we go look for them in the brain, and sometimes we find evidence for that thing and usually we don't. And that's a very respectable way to do science. You come up with a hypothesis and you go test it. But there's another way to do science that I'm quite excited about. And that is, instead of asking very specific questions of nature, instead we collect a whole big bunch of data and use math to try to discover the causal essence of the structure of our data. So starting a few years ago, my colleague Josh McDermott and I, working with our then grad student, Sam Norman Hegner, decided to look at the organization of auditory cortex. And so we decided to use this different method of just scanning people while they were listening to lots and lots of different sounds. And so we recorded or collected recordings of 165 different everyday sounds. Things like a dog barking, a toilet flushing, an ambulance siren, birds chirping, people talking, that kind of things. Sounds that are easily identifiable from a 2-second clip and that are heard frequently in daily life. And we scanned people with functional MRI while they listened to these sounds. And then we took those data, threw away all the labels and took just the magnitude of response of each little piece of brain to each of those 165 sounds and did some math that basically said, take this big pile of data and tell me what its basic components are. That math is called independent component analysis, but the details don't matter. What happened was we found that 6 components account for most of our data, and 2 of them replicated known things about auditory cortex, like that some little patches of auditory cortex respond more to high frequency sounds and some more to low frequency sounds. And that was known before. So the fact that this new method rediscovered something we knew, that's called a positive control, and that was very reassuring. It also found 2 components that were not exactly new and not exactly old, but kind of made sense. But what we were most excited about was the last 2 components. And so here's one of them. And so the component takes the form of a magnitude of response to each of the 165 sounds that's shown here. And these sounds are color-coded by different categories of sound. So if you look at it, you see that all the sounds that produced a really strong response in this component, if we average over those categories, we can see, oh, it's speech, English speech and foreign speech. So that's that little patch that I showed you at the beginning of the talk, that orange patch on the side of the temporal lobe. And here it is responding to English speech and foreign speech that our subjects don't understand. And that tells us that this is not a language region that's about understanding the meaning of language. It's a speech perception region that's about perceiving the phonemes that make up your speech. So that was cool. And we get an intermediate response to music if there's vocals in it. So there's some speech content there. And a much lower response to non-speech vocalizations like laughing and crying and sighing, and much lower to everything else. Okay, so that's a speech selective component very clearly. That had sort of been known before, but nobody had measured its response to all these different stimuli. So our evidence is stronger about the extreme specificity of this region. But it was component 6 that was most exciting to us. And here's component 6. And if you look at it, you see, oh, there's all this blue and purple sounds that drive it strongly. And then it kind of goes off a cliff and everything else is much lower. So what are the blue and purple sounds? Oh, that's music. And so there are, 20 or 30 different instrumental music sounds that produce a strong response. All of these up here, 20 or 30 different sounds that have music with vocals that all produce a very strong response, and everything else produces a much lower response. So this is a music selective component. And this is pretty cool because this had really not been observed before. Many people, including us, had looked, but it's a property of this particular kind of data analysis that it can pull apart different neural populations that are clustered together in the brain, and it can kind of infer that there's this very selective music component, even though it overlaps spatially with lots of other responses in the brain. And so we think that's cool because it shows, among other things, that music isn't simply a byproduct of speech in the sense that once you have speech selective mechanisms in the brain, I should back up and say why all humans have music. And people have been puzzling for centuries about why. Darwin puzzled about this. He considered this one of the biggest mysteries about the human mind, is why do all human cultures have music? And one of the stories has been that music co-opts systems that are really there for speech and language, which is easy to understand why, what the adaptive value is of speech and language. But this shows that that account isn't right. No, music and speech are completely non-overlapping in the brain. They're not part of the same mechanism. It doesn't tell us why we have music, but it rules out one of the hypotheses. Now, whenever you find something surprising like this, a scientist's first response should be, really? That was my response. I thought, this is great, but we had to do a lot of math to find this, and that made me suspicious. I like seeing stuff in the raw data. And that's why I was thrilled when we had an opportunity to collect intracranial recordings, like I showed you before from the Japanese gentleman, but from different subjects, listening to the same sounds. People who had electrodes in their brains for surgical, for clinical reasons, and who were kind enough to listen to our sounds and let us record from their brain. And what we found is over 13 patients with electrodes shown in these locations here, we found single electrodes with striking selectivity. So for example, here's one, this is time on this axis. Here's one that responds very selectively to speech sounds, both foreign and native speech. Here's one that responds selectively to music. And you see the vocal music in pink and the non-vocal music in blue and all the other sounds down there. That's a very, very selective response to music. But with intracranial electrodes, we not only validated what we had inferred before from functional MRI, we found something new. And that is, we found some neural responses that were selective for vocal music in particular. And that's shown in pink here. And that was a real surprise. The response wasn't just the addition of a speech response and a music response. It was a selective response to music and vocals. And we don't know why that exists in the brain. We could speculate that vocal music is probably both evolutionarily and developmentally the first kind of music humans have. But why that means there should be selective machinery in the brain is a good question. We don't know the answer. Going back to this question of what are the specializations in the brain, very recently, we've applied this same method to revisit the responses in visual cortex down here. And with this new method, we discovered something new, and that is in roughly the location of these green patches, we find a selective response in visual cortex to images of food. And on the one hand, that makes perfect sense. Obviously, humans care a lot about food. It's necessary for survival. It's at the core of our cultural identity and our social practices. But to me, it was a big surprise to find it in visual cortex, but there it is. Okay, so those are a few of the other specializations we found in the brain. And I should say that for music, we've also shown that music selective response is not a byproduct of formal musical training. So we scanned people who've never had a music lesson in their life, but of course hear music all the time. All normal hearing adults hear music regularly. And that music selective response is there independent of training. So it's really quite different in that from the visual word form area that I described before. This here, it's in orange right there, which arises only after you are explicitly taught to read. Music selective response arises just from normal ambient experience with music. Okay, so that's only two questions. There's so many more. How does all of this structure arise in development? We don't know the answer, but I'll give you a few snippets. So there's a lot of studies that have argued that in visual cortex, these regions arise very slowly and are continuing to develop straight through adolescence. And in fact, there's one study in monkeys. So monkeys also have face selective patches, and that enables you to do experiments that would be unethical in humans. And so some researchers have raised baby monkeys without ever letting them see faces. And these monkeys have plenty of visual experience. They have plenty of social experience. They hang out with other monkeys in the dark. They hear them, smell them, feel them, but they never see faces. And the humans who take care of them wear welding masks over their faces. So those baby monkeys who never see faces do not have face selective regions like normal monkeys do. And so the researchers in that study said that visual experience with faces is necessary to wire up a face selective region of the cortex. And so that's all very interesting, but our response to that was, really? Let's take another whack at this question. And so what we did, I should say prior studies had looked at children age 4 and up. And that was very interesting, but really we want to look earlier during infancy. And it is nearly impossible to scan infants. they wiggle and their parents get nervous and the whole thing is kind of a train wreck. But my amazing colleague, Rebecca Sachs, shown here with her then grad student, Ben Dean, and her star subject, her own son, Arthur, figured out how to scan infants, especially Arthur, but then eventually others. And what they showed is that same structure of face and scene responses that I showed you before is present very early in development in 6-month-old infants. And that's pretty awesome. But they couldn't see in their study how selective the response was in these regions. And so it was just because it's so hard to get good data from infants. But then the amazing Heather Kosakowski, shown here, receiving her PhD just a few months ago, flanked by Rebecca and me at MIT graduation. Heather showed, she just figured out how to get better data from infants. And she showed that the face, place, and body selective regions are all present and with adult-like selectivity by 6 months of age. And so it looks like, no, these regions do not take many, many years to arise. What about this question of whether visual experience is really required? Well, my postdoc, Bratan Murthy, decided to take a whack at this question in a different way. And so he decided to scan congenitally blind people who've never had visual experience as they touch with their hands 3D printed objects like this. And so they're lying in the scanner like this. This is looking into the scanner bore. While these objects are on a cardboard disc that Ratan is rotating from outside the scanner so that the subject can just feel each object as it goes by. And there are faces and places and hands and chairs. And what here for comparison is the selective response of a sighted subject looking at these stimuli, showing you the face selective response that we normally see. And what do we see in the congenitally blind people touching these stimuli? We see something very similar. And so that tells us that you don't need visual experience for that face selective response to arise in a very similar location. If you look closely, the absolute magnitude of response is lower in the blind subjects than the touching the faces than the sighted subjects seeing the faces, but it's also very selective and in the same location. Okay, so no, you don't need visual experience. And so this tells us that these regions arise very, very early in development and the face regions arise even in people who've never seen faces. It still leaves many mysteries, but it's starting to constrain the problem. We're also very interested in how these regions arise evolutionarily. And I'll just mention that here's the bottom surface of the brain in humans showing you face, color, and place selective regions in purple, blue, and green. In monkeys, in their high-level visual cortex, you see not just the same selective regions, this is a side view of monkey brain, but you see them in the same order in the brain, faces, color, places. And I think that's incredibly cool because it's not obvious why color selective stuff should be between faces and places. That seems more like an accident of evolution. And if it's an accident of evolution, it suggests that this whole patch of the cortex is inherited from a common ancestor that we had with macaques, and that would be 30 million years ago. So it doesn't prove that, but it's strongly suggestive. And I'll just say, without dragging you through all the data, that I think high-level auditory cortex is in fact very different between humans and monkeys because we use it very differently than monkeys. We use it for language and for music. And although monkeys have calls that sometimes carry some meaning, it's nothing like human language. And I think that has manifested itself in many differences in auditory cortex between humans and monkeys. Okay. Haynes has promised to interrupt me when I have 5 minutes. I know I'm getting near the end, but I would love to discuss one more point, which is what we ultimately want to understand about these regions is not just to be able to stick a word label on top of each of them, but to understand in terms of the actual computations, what is going on in each of those regions. And if we had a full understanding, we would be able to implement that in a computer program as an implementation of our actual understanding of what goes on in each region. And we're not there yet. But there's been a lot of sudden recent progress with the advent of convolutional neural networks. This is the big advance in AI of the last 10 years. This is the reason your cell phone can suddenly recognize faces, recognize speech, and do all this stuff you don't even ask it to do, and it suddenly volunteers its ability to do all this stuff. All of that is based on machine learning in artificial neural networks. And very briefly, the vision networks take an image like this in the front, and they feed it into a series of layers. This is all implemented in a computer program, in which you have filters at each layer that extract different kinds of information. And these networks are trained so that at the top end, it will deliver the identity of the object in the image. And suddenly these networks are working really well. And that's important for vision scientists because it's the first time we've had any plausible model of how computations might work in the brain. It doesn't mean that the brain works the same way, but it's the first time we've had even a hypothesis to test. And further, work from a number of labs have shown that these things show remarkable similarities to the brain. They absolutely did not have to, but they do. So for example, if you take these networks and you just train them to recognize objects, and then you look at what kinds of selectivities you find in those filters, you find that early layers of the network have filters that look a lot like the properties of neurons at early stages of the visual system. Mid layers match mid layers and high layers match high layers, suggesting that training a neural network and optimizing it for object recognition and training up a brain through evolution and development has produced at least a somewhat similar solution to the problem of visual object recognition. And that's pretty amazing. So what Ratanamurthy has done is say, okay, given the similarity of these models, can we build computational models of what's going on in the face, place, and body regions? And I know I'm over time, so I'll just briefly say that what he's shown is that you can take these models and by selecting units at a high level of the model and summing them up with certain weights, you can very accurately predict the response of the face, place, and body regions to new stimuli. I'm going to skip over this because I'm going to run out of time. And I will just mention one other cool thing we can do with these models. And that is we can ask what I think of as maybe the most fundamental question of why do we have selective regions of the brain in the first place? Okay, I'm skipping over some stuff here. So why should the brain have a face selective region? Why is that a good way to design a brain? And so what my former postdoc Katarina Dobbs and my lab tech Julio Martinez did was we said, okay, we hypothesize that we have face specific regions in the brain because face recognition just requires different kinds of computations from object recognition. And we asked that question by testing one of these deep net models. We trained it only on face recognition, and we trained another one only on object recognition, leaving out all the faces. And what we find is that the face trained network is really good at recognizing new faces and terrible at object recognition. And the object trained network shows the opposite property. And so what I think that what that shows is that the features that are optimized for face recognition are just different from the ones that are optimized for object recognition. But that's not yet the strongest test. So then we predicted, what if we take one network and we train it on both face and object recognition? My hypothesis was that that network should do really badly because it's going to be forced to solve these two different tasks. It will make a bad compromise and it won't work well at either of those tasks. And I was totally wrong in that prediction. Here's its performance on the face and object task on the networks trained only on faces and only on objects for comparison. And here's how the dual trained network performed when it was trained, when it was trained on both faces and objects. It did just as well. So at first I was like, damn, too bad. I liked that hypothesis and apparently it's wrong. And then I thought, wait a minute, let's look inside that dual trained network and let's see what it's doing. And what we find is if you look inside, you see that actually it has spontaneously segregated itself into two systems that increase in segregation at later layers. So it has basically discovered the same organization in the brain. It has realized that the way to solve the problem of face recognition and object recognition is to allocate different parts of the system to those two tasks. And I love this result because I think it's starting to enable us to say, not just how is the brain organized and how does it work, but why is it organized the way it is? What it tells us is that the brain seems to be organized in a way to optimize it to solve certain problems. And I'm just going to end with my overview slide there and say thank you. And I will happily take questions. Thanks very much.
Well, thank you, Nancy. Thank you so much for this extremely interesting and fun talk. I think there's a lot of questions on the chat, and I look forward to discussing them with you now. Maybe we can remove the slide here, and so we can just be face-to-face, so to speak, there. Thank you. So maybe I'll begin with the, since this is a bilingual seminar, maybe I'll begin with a question that arose in connection with this last experiment you were describing. If you have a bilingual individual, do they somehow partition the language portion of the brain into these two languages? Do you have any information about how that works?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I have not worked on that myself, but Evelina Fedorenko, whose work I mentioned, has done a number of studies on that. And what she has shown is that actually there's remarkable overlap in the brain in the regions that are engaged in processing the different languages. So if you speak English and Arabic, those things are right on top of each other in the brain. She's also shown in a study that was just published a few months ago, she scanned people who speak, I forget how many different languages, but like 30 or 40 different languages spanning all the major language classes in the world. And she looked at the neural responses despite the many really deep linguistic differences across these languages. She showed that actually they all produce very much the same pattern of activation, showing that we really, you know, independent of the language we speak, our basic internal machinery for processing that language is very much the same.
I think Noam Chomsky would like that information. But does the language portion expand at all because of all this extra processing?
Yes. So Ev did another study. I'm not involved. I'm just a fan of her work. She did another study where she found unique people who speak many, many different languages. These are called super polyglots, and it's kind of a thing. Like they're just people who are obsessed with learning languages. One is this wonderful guy who was a janitor in a hotel in New York, and it was just his thing. And he spoke 30 languages really fluently with beautiful native accents. Amazing. And so she scanned him and another 10, 20 people who were super polyglots and asked how their language system differed from everyone else. And the answer was, it's smaller. And this was a surprise to Ev and to me and to everyone else. We don't have a good story about it, but it's as though your language system, I don't know, just gets more efficient or something. I don't know, but it's pretty cool.
Amazing. How about different writing systems? There's a separate area of the brain for understanding writing.
Yeah. So let's see, what have I done? I have scanned, there's a lot of work on this and I don't know all of it. This has become such a huge field. But way back when we were trying to figure out, you know, if we were trying to find out whether the selectivity of the visual reading regions is dependent on that individual's experience. And so we scanned people reading English and Hebrew who either spoke and read just English or English and Hebrew. And we found that the very same regions responded to both. I'm guessing that would be true for any orthography, but we haven't tested other orthographies.
So another interesting question here is, I'll read it, as humanity involves new tools like PC and the internet and concepts like the cloud, how does the brain incorporate corresponding new representations? Text representations evolved over hundreds of years, but brains haven't grown in that time. So what happens? Do we repurpose older sections that had different purposes in the past for these new needs?
Yeah, that's a great question. This is what I think the people in AI call, are striving for with what they call artificial general intelligence, right? And so it's like, it's kind of the cognitive signature of human beings that we're not just good at the particular things that we're good at. Like we're all great at hearing speech and understanding language and recognizing faces and all that stuff that we've been doing for much of our lives and for which we probably have some form or other of, you know, evolutionary preparedness to learn those functions. We're also good at solving totally weird novel tasks, much better than any other species as far as we know. Like other species have all kinds of talents from, you know, building spider webs to sonar to you name it, all kinds of talents we don't have. But those tend to be very specific. They tend to be rooted in the evolution of those animals. They tend not to lead to general purpose abilities to solve novel problems. So humans are great at that. And we don't know exactly how humans do that. That is one of the big cutting edge questions in artificial intelligence and cognitive science right now is how do we, it's sometimes it's called zero shot learning. How do we not just learn from a whole bunch of examples, but solve a problem right off the bat on the first try? And I don't have a good answer for you other than I agree it's a fundamental question. We're just starting to work now on the use of novel tools. So we haven't really formulated this whole line of work yet, but we're, this is just behavioral work. We're giving people virtual reality so that we can design novel scenarios for them and record all of their movements and eye movements and the whole bit. And we're giving them a hierarchy of different, different tasks to solve. And these will also be run on monkeys. They're all, we call them the find the grape tasks. So there's always a configuration of objects on a table in front of you. And there's an object you want. For monkeys, it's a grape. For humans, maybe we'll give it some monetary value. People just have to quickly, people and monkeys have to quickly find the grape. We'll also run this on robots so we can compare human and monkey performance to robot performance. And the general agenda is to try to come up with algorithms that humans are running that enable them to optimize their ability to do this, even when they have to design a novel tool. So for example, in the simple case, there's a few objects, you don't see the grape, you move an object, there it is, done. But in other cases, you know, the grape is visible, but it's under a shelf and you can't reach your hand in there. And so you have to figure out that there's an elongated skinny object that can reach under that shelf and scoop it out, right? So this is a way to study novel tool use. All this to say, we have no idea, but we consider it a fundamental, important question, and we're interested in trying to figure out how humans do it.
Do these cortical responses you're discovering, do they, especially to sound, for example, do they differ by gender? You haven't spoken about gender differences at all.
Yeah, I'm allergic to gender differences in the brain because I don't trust the popular media with coverage of it. Whatever you find, it will be evidence of some kind of problem with women. No matter what you find, the region is bigger, the region is smaller, the region is different. And so I just don't want to give any fodder to that evil machine. I was actually pressured a bunch of years ago. I was being funded by actually an amazing guy, you may know him, Haynes, Jim Simons, a serious mathematician and now also a billionaire. Who's funded a lot of research in autism. And he was funding me to do a little bit of work in autism a bunch of years ago. And he asked me about whether there are gender differences in the face area of the brain. And I gave Jim my usual response of, I'm not even going to look because I don't want to, you know, feed the evil machine. And he said, listen, we have a serious scientific question in autism. What is the basis of the big gender ratio in autism? Why is it so much more common? Boys and girls, we need to understand why that is. And you can look in your data and see if your face areas are different. I said, okay. That's a one, you're funding me. And two, that's even more relevantly, that's a good scientific argument. So I went and looked and I did not find any difference whatsoever in the size or location or selectivity or anything about the face regions. But I haven't looked in the rest of the brain because nobody's twisted my arm. The basic story is this: that everything that I talked about today, as far as we can tell, is just present in pretty much everyone in a remarkably similar form.
Mm.
That's what I like about it. Is I just think this is just what it is to be a human being, is to have this machine with this very particular structure running in your head.
Mm. So I'm reading something that Ovai just put up in the chat. Have you been able to associate areas of the human brain with feelings, like a mother seeing her child or an engaged couple seeing their precious other?
Yeah. I mean, there are clearly lots of brain systems that are involved in emotional responses. I tend to focus more on the cortex, this outer sheet of the brain, whereas a lot of that emotional stuff goes on deep down in the brain. And so a lot is known, including in research on animals, where you have many more powerful methods than we have with humans, right? With humans, on very rare occasions, there's a neurosurgeon who needs, for clinical reasons, to put electrodes in a location we're interested in, and the patients are kind enough to let us record. But these are very, very rare and precious data. With animals, people have spectacular methods to activate just this patch of brain for just this moment and just this subclass of cells in that patch of brain. And so they've been able to really take apart entire circuits underlying emotional responses. So I just heard a talk a week ago by Katrine Dulac at Harvard, who does this amazing work in rodents. She's found populations of cells that respond selectively in rodents who are undergoing social isolation. Rodents who have not had contact, rodents are very social like humans are, and these mice have not had contact with other rodents for, I don't know, a day or two, and these neurons in this tiny little nucleus, the preoptic nucleus of the hypothalamus, fire a lot during social isolation. She's found another pool of neurons right next door to that pool of neurons that fire when those rodents first encounter another rodent and engage in social interaction. So I think that these are things that we probably share a lot with other animals, our basic emotional responses to social situations and other people and all the broad suite of emotions that we experience from that. Mm-hmm. Although I will also say that a lot of the actual nature of an emotional experience for a human is not just kind of the raw energy, good, bad, strong, weak, but the cognitive overlay, the interpretation we put on it. Why do we feel sad or devastated or inspired or any of this? And that has a lot of high level content. And that part is surely particular to humans or distinctive in humans. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Along the same line, so you were analogizing the cortex to a big pizza. I like that image. And really, these maps that you're drawing are just the surface. And so the question I have is, what are there techniques out there that may become available at some point to understand what happens when you go vertically into the crust? And
yeah. So basically, what you have is about 40% of the volume of the brain is basically wires, right? So the cortex is kind of cell bodies and it's got layers and lots of internal circuits within that cortical sheet, but within that pizza. But then underneath it, you just have these massive bundles of wires that carry information distally from one region of the cortex to another. And so lots of people study that. There's many ways to study it. One method is called diffusion imaging. You may have seen these beautiful kind of colorful spaghetti pictures of brains with kind of fine lines going every which way. Those are mathematically inferred long-range connections from diffusion imaging, which looks at the axis of water diffusion in the brain. And the idea is if you have a fiber bundle, like think of a whole bunch of basically the wires coming off of a neuron known as an axon, but it's a whole bundle of wires. Biological wires, water diffuses along the length of those wires more than across them because there's fat layers around each axon. And so the water goes along the length, both inside and outside those axons. And so with diffusion imaging, you can find that axis. And so in that way, you can track through the brain major fiber bundles. The challenge for me is I desperately want to know the actual physical structural connectivity of each of those brain regions I study. But that method is not very good for you can follow the big bundles, But then when you get to a bundle, you want to know exactly how does it connect from that bundle to the little piece of the relevant piece of the pizza. Mm. And that method doesn't work that well. Mm. So we have a real challenge in humans discovering all the connectivity.
But even within that pizza, the cortex, it's got depth as well that must effectively be a neural network.
Absolutely. And there's a bunch of work that's going on. Certainly in animals, you can do that. In monkeys, you can record selectively from different layers of the cortex. But actually, even in humans now, if you have a very fancy scanner, for example, it's 7 Tesla rather than 3 Tesla, which I usually use 3 Tesla, but I have colleagues who have 7 Tesla scanners, and you can get higher resolution sometimes at the level of layers. And so mm-hmm. then we know that, you know, information comes up from the thalamus into layer 4, and then it goes in a particular order through the other layers. And you can start to take apart things like which things correspond to feed forward processing in the cortex and which correspond to feedback mm-hmm. by looking at different layers. And that's a kind of cutting edge, cool direction of research right now.
Where you can really start to see the mechanism there. Interesting. These maps show a lot of areas with specific purposes, these colored areas. And then you showed the general purpose areas in white there, but there's still a lot of gray in those maps. Any idea what that's for?
Yeah, so I should say that image that I show you guys is very idiosyncratic. I have my favorite blobs on there, ones that I've spent a lot of time studying that I really believe there are a lot of other claims. There are thousands of papers that talk about functions of like the whole cortex and either reflects my, usually my state of ignorance of some of that research, or in some cases my, shall we say, slight skepticism about some of the findings in that area. So there's lots more known that I talked about today. For example, there's a lot of people tackling the very challenging question of the organization of the frontal lobes, right? It's basically a whole third of the cortex up here that is engaged in these very high level functions. I find those very difficult to think about because we know from monkey neurophysiology that the response properties of individual neurons change from moment to moment, depending on the task you're doing, that many of those regions have very general functions. It's just harder to put your finger on what's going on up there. But in some ways, I think some of those will be some of the biggest mysteries and the biggest insights ultimately about how cognition works when we understand those regions.
Daniel Kahneman has this distinction between thinking fast and thinking slow. I wonder if you have any way of interpreting that from your work.
Yeah. Okay. So a lot of the stuff that I talked about are these systems that are pretty, they're not necessarily innate just because they're in very systematic locations, but they're very particular systems optimized for a particular task, right? And so those things are extremely efficient. They work really fast. So take object recognition. I could show you 10 different complex natural images in a second, and you would get the gist of each one. Okay, 8. But anyway, a lot, really fast. Like your visual system is really fast. Similarly, probably many of you have had this experience. If you're listening to a YouTube lecture and it's too boring, you can crank it up to 2x speed and you can still basically follow it if it's not too complicated, right? So our language system is also remarkably fast. And beautiful work by people who study language processing going back many decades has shown that we have actually figured out the word a person is saying often before they finish saying it. And if you think about how people work in conversation, right, there's this very rapid back and forth, and there's beautiful lines of work showing that as you listen, you're talking one-on-one with somebody and they're going blah, 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 and you feel them coming to the end of a sentence, you have already started to plan in detail what you're going to say next before they finish speaking. So those systems are extremely rapid and online, and they can be contrasted with what you do when you're thinking about, you know, I don't know, like the hard kind of things we do. Like, I don't know, there's a person in my lab and they're struggling and they're really unhappy and they're not productive. And why is that? And how could I be helpful? And do I want to do some carrot? Do I want to do some stick? Are those both, should I just try to find out what's, I mean, these are hard things that we think about for long periods of time. And I think that, you know, we humans do all of that. We have these very fast, efficient systems like the ones I showed you in the brain. And then we have probably in some of those areas I didn't color in, maybe some of those white regions, the things that we use for very long-term, difficult, deliberate, slow reasoning. And at some sense, some of that maps onto, I think, what Kahneman was talking about.
Mm-hmm. Is there any evidence of a change in organization for people with schizophrenia?
Right. So I'm not totally up on the latest with schizophrenia, but I can tell you a what I suspect is true and what is shockingly true in the case of autism, right? So autism is a, you know, is a very particular thing, and in its severe forms really affects many aspects of cognition and daily life. And shockingly, you cannot tell from any kind of brain scan whether a person has autism or not. Now, we know there's differences in their brain, so it does not mean there aren't differences. It's a statement about how impoverished our tools are. And so I think what this is really telling us is that tools like functional MRI are wonderfully useful for the fundamental research questions of, you know, what is the organization of the human mind? I think it's great for that kind of thing. But they're woefully inadequate so far for understanding clinical disorders that are so devastating to people and that we would love to make progress on. And, you know, on the other hand, for that reason, a lot of people study models of clinical disorders, whether it's schizophrenia or autism or Parkinson's or whatever it is, in mice, where you have, as I mentioned before, really spectacular methods for taking apart circuits and understanding how they work and manipulating them and trying different kinds of interventions. And the trouble there is that all of these disorders have been cured again and again and again in mice. And then those cures just don't translate to humans. And so there's a real challenge right now with using neuroscience research to address the really basic problems, that the basic ways that brains can go wrong.
That's the future.
Yeah.
So another question, maybe my last, that arose in the chat was, where can we find that video that I mentioned in the introduction to you, a video of you?
Oh, Joyce Ajluni, that one? Yes. I think that YouTube censored it. I'm sure people on this call know all about YouTube censorship. I had posted way back, I mean, I've been embarrassingly lax for years, but back when I was posting lots of this stuff, I found that it would just disappear off of YouTube, which is extremely annoying, but that's my guess, because the text is still there and it refers to those things. So I can try reposting them if I can find them. But, you know, I was basically using YouTube as my storage for those videos. And so when they censor it, I'm in trouble. So anyway, what can we do? There's still a big fight to be fought.
What can we do? Well, the Bisson Lecture Series is helping to fight that fight a little bit. You know, there's so much more to discuss about this fascinating topic. I'm cognizant of the time, though.
Can I just interrupt and say one thing? It was on my front slide, but if anybody wants to learn more about this, my whole MIT undergrad course is available on MIT's OpenCourseWare for free. I won't know if you watch or don't watch, totally up to you, but if you just Google, you know, MIT, Kanwisher, the human brain, OpenCourseWare, or OCW, it will come up. Sorry to interrupt, go ahead.
I think I may have watched a piece of that where you actually shave your head to show where certain parts are happening there. Okay, thank you for that. That maybe we can put the link up on the chat if there's time. So thank you so much, Nancy. This was really educational and fun. And thank you, Numer Kassis, for this Arabic translation. It's been going on this whole time behind the scenes. And thank you all for your support of the Bisson Lecture Series. The next Bisson Lecture, it'll be by another MIT colleague, Professor Esther Duflo, 2019 Nobel Laureate in Economics, and her title is Social Experiments to Fight Poverty, From Research to Policy. And please note that the time is different. It's off by an hour, I think, from when we normally meet. So I look forward to seeing you all there in a month. Thank you very much.
Thank you.